infiniteness of human knowledge garners momentum in the past, evolves in the future with strong reference to the past, akin to algorithms of the future based on the mathematical calculations of the past, reference to the past. Our contemporary needs of a green and sustainable practices are connected to our roots, and hence many a time of our vision of the future encompasses references to the ancient timeline and practices. In architecture, this is even relevant. This is true. And today, to talk more about elements of architecture and design inspired by the past and the desired by the future, we have with us Mr. Yatin Pandya. Yatin Pandya is an author, academician, researcher, as well as a practicing architect. With his firm, Footprints Earth, that stands for Environment, Architecture, Research, Technology, Housing. He has authored several books, especially on concepts of space in traditional Indian architecture. He has won numerous awards for his works, the most recent being the United States Currystone Foundation Design Prize for Sustainable Practice. So let us welcome Mr. Yatin Pandya.
All right, so thank you. Very gist of what my biases may be, or what the point of discussion I want to add here, similar lines that has been talked about, that sustainability, it's kind of a way of life. It's a phenomenon and not a formula. And therefore, its kind of contextual appropriateness is something that needs to be addressed. What pandemic has taught us, you know, we had a pre kind of this short meeting, and I was beginning to say that it's been a great equalizer. And in fact, it has solved many of these conviction problems about some of the things for which we used to run seminars. I think now everybody on their own has understood the value of some of these qualities that we talk about, quality of life that we talk about. So it has taught us humility, that we are only a microcosm of the cosmos. It has been an equalizer affecting all equally. Frugality has something that we could learn. Plurality, that it's for all. And sustainability, of course. So living with nature had become a kind of outcome of some of these happenings recently, the positive part of it. And as said, that post-pandemic, we had all given up, that we are far too many people on this planet, and nothing can be changed about this planet's condition. But nature corrected its own course simply by not having undue excessive system in place. So we learned the difference between essential and excessive, that with undue system not being in place, the pollution, the cleanliness of air, and the existence of other flora, fauna, all kind of told us that it's still possible, and that's why we need to pause and think about turning this constraint into a virtue, where development to be based on two fundamental harmonies of existence, human to human and human to nature, which was very evident. You know, all over the world, the clothing has been different, people's fixture and even skin colors appropriately have been different, food has been different. And so was their vernacular architecture. Vernacular doesn't mean necessarily of the past, but of the place and for the people. That being the case, are we able to relate and identify? Like previous ones, we were able to say place in terms of people, culture, and the kind of climate, etc. But this one is impossible to define, and this is all over the world. You would innocently accept the names I put in, but this might have been a joke, it could put anywhere, anything. What we need to understand is both have been the Kerala. Which Kerala are we looking for? Which Jaipur should be for us, and which Kolkata we should be driving towards? And this comes in a right time when last decade we have spent defining what is smart city. No synonym would say smart is not smart, but when this is the picture to signify in government websites what is smart, that's a frightening kind of a call. That's where we wonder and see that what should a city in terms of its development vision should entail, that it should become home to community, to living environment, it should have housing for the everybody, and therefore fill up the deficit paradox of quality and quantity, rural urban divide, rich poor diversity, infrastructure, cleanliness, social issues, nutritional thing, all need to be addressed by a single facet. And this is actually the win-win solution we need to find, and it was possible and it still is possible. Gandhi was one of the person who told us with a very simple tool of charkha that how gender equity, how the sort of strengthening of the rural area, economic decentralization, number of things with just one simple instrument you could find. So what is that you could pick up for our context here? So any development has to run through these five lenses: timeless aesthetic, because building lasts beyond us; socio-cultural appropriateness, because we always do for somebody; environmental sustainability, because we are far too many and resources are frugal; economic affordability, without that it won't be viable; and of course the structural strength to match up for the expected life of these. The first thing, therefore, we need to relook, and that's what again pandemic taught us, with how little could that be. Without much compromise or any compromise, we could still live positively. So we need to understand the contextual norms based on place and realities, and more performance related rather than prescriptive, otherwise we end up into disasters by aping rather than adapting. So sustainability, as said, has multiple dimensions. It's not just the environmental sustainability, but aesthetic timelessness, which can be signified by many of our classical architecture, that they have not one off, like very favorite of mine, even though utilitarian device such as the step well, which has enormous sustainability in terms of resource management ideas, but even otherwise as an architectural journey, it's one of the most defining spatial narrative here. Then the idea of socio-cultural appropriateness. There was a study in Japan that revealed that if this formal dressing was kind of exempted and they were able to wear the informal, there was a 2 degree warmer temperature of AC which would have been as comfortable. So it was undue dress pattern coding which was the culprit to have to jack up the AC. So if in a hot, humid climate, people are bare-chested or they are with the loincloth, are they primitive or they are the most smartly and appropriately dressed? With the kind of cultural understanding, you can see these three slides here. The left has been the traditional quarter, small alley, yet positive. Middle one, as an imposed regulation of the service lane and most dirty environment, because the kitchen is the most convenient place from where you throw all your muck into that lane. Simply by turning that window into door, you can transform the entire thing. The idea of open space, the street, like this is Ahmedabad UNESCO recognized street, which is with a blurred interface becoming an extended living area, versus 15% by law set aside space fails to deliver. Too large an open space is not giving the same dividend, but the wasted space and unduly encroached eventually. And it's not the money, it's the mindset. Like in a slum, in a dense area, with a rightly located along the junction of movement and shared giving space, can become very successful group open space, while Ballard Estate, with very beautiful and rich patrons residing in this building, but with this attitude of a building window being covered with a sewer line, shows that I have nothing to do at the back, and that kind of attitude has relegated into an ugly space, even in a very expensive real estate. And that is where we have to also look at the building type. When we're talking about sustainable cities, etc., building type to me, especially for living, high rise, I don't even understand why it has come about. People often talk about economics, but it's a vicious cycle. If I can build more, I would be able to pay more for that same piece of land. Here you can see it's a comparison. Both left and right are exactly same FAR, which are more or less working in Ahmedabad, except for a few exceptions. And this was happening in the traditional quarter with 2.7 FSI since centuries. So it's just the way you kind of slice it, and you can build the buildings with the kind of better terraced and outdoor open space sort of an environment, which again the pandemic has taught us the need for. Where we have aped has actually been a very sort of sustainable environment. For example, this is a kind of a urban design guideline which was then taken into building bylaws, saying that you can do whatever to your building, but on the day of the sunlit equinox, you should not be casting 50% of the area under shade because of your building. So you do whatever to your building, but you ensure the right to sun. So we need to have such performance-based progressive bylaws, which lately, at least in our context in this city, has been very regressive. Environmental sustainability, land as a resource, and we built very compactly. That was a tablet from 2nd century BC. The same attitude, I mean, look at the change in attitude. Same area that a medieval city of Dubrovnik, again, a World Heritage City, 40 acre of land for several thousand families, self-sufficient middle city, is exactly the same area we spent in Cloverleaf intersection for simply not having to slow down vehicle from 100 kilometers an hour. We had valued this with vitality. This is urban space even today in Ahmedabad, morning a cow grazing ground, afternoon a business district, evening an eatery. And even Mr. Corbusier showed us that in Bombay we talk about space crunch, but I have yet seen many buildings which have taken advantage of the roof. This is Corbusier in Ahmedabad showing the roof which has been greened up. If you don't see left picture, not possible to believe that middle one is down, first and second floor. And this, we had this also with water, that siting of the building to its detailing all corresponded with integration of this natural resources architecturally, environmentally, spatially. That Munj Talab and its collection of water kind of choreographed into a formal arrival. Kund from there, once manually lifted with the water wheel or ramp, it goes by gravity into different floor hammams, aesthetic floor channels, ground floor for the courtiers, and then again coming down by gravity of Mughal chadars, and then converting into Kapoor Talab with the snowdrop water wasted. As said, we are responsible three ways. We alter the landscape. To begin with, we are highest consumer of the building energy and also equally producer of the pollutant. So point is, where are we spending that? Like this hoarding could have electrified 300 households for 3 hours every night. Instead, it is one hoarding guzzling that, and it makes city ugly as hell. So what have been the practices that we have found, like what Mr. Sumitji was explaining, that once is an insulative mask, both for cold and hot climate. And we can often say and argue that, oh, thick masses don't work in urban context, we're losing space. No, you could have folded wall, you could have storages in the periphery, etc. So there's still no compromise kind of a wisdom. Multi-tiered roofs. Only insulation is a fallacy of also a lot of rating systems. I think it needs to go with the ventilation, because hot air has to be evacuated, and that is where these hot air escape and through tiers of the roof, etc. Outdoor spaces, all the time you don't have to overbuild. It's already been talked about fenestration, where one-way communication from inside you can look out, but from outside you can't look in. Like Mr. Laurie Baker, the Venturi effect is a modern version of the same. So air picks up velocity, and Bernoulli principle, that it also microcools by having compressed and then released. In India, we have very high sky component. So using daylight, daytime, any artificial light is a crime. We don't have, nobody has given us a license to use exhaust in a bathroom and corridors with no ventilation and light. I think that's a criminal liberty we have taken as professional. So we need to think of ways where you have to diffuse light. This was the old quarter, as I said, 2.7 FSI, these vertically projecting profiles. So you have natural shading, courtyard doing its microclimate base, and not only climatic, but socio-culturally, water harvested in every cistern of the house, mass production with craft base, so every house had its own uniqueness. It was aesthetically pleasant, and yet there was variations I could identify. The spaces were multiply used, morning for daily chores, afternoon for kind of play areas and hawking, evenings for socializing and festivities. And also the, as I say, way of life, there were fixtures like swing, hitchka, where what fan did with electric power, we did with muscle power to cut the air and have evaporative cooling of the perspiration, etc. And even the kind of food, it's a very naive observation, but warmer the climate, spicier the palate, so that with tannin, etc., that you sweat, and when you sweat with the evaporative cooling, you feel better body comfort. So those are the kinds of things with which you can interpret today for the short of time. I'm not losing my projects, but I'm just saying that glamour and beauty both catch attention. Steel and glass glamour may seem new, but nowadays you don't even give second glance. So I think it gets back to the eternal beauty, which is integral and timeless. And that's the call. I think over century, whether we have changed is a question that we have to put. We put too much onus on technology. I think we have to take first step first. First is the way of life, then is the design, then is the gadget, and then are the kind of other implements, etc. So 100 years apart, are we really different? And if we are different, in what way? Is the thing to mull over and think our directions for tomorrow based on the norms. There was a technology that connected the family. Now it's a similar technology, but it even on a dining table separates the people. We already had WhatsApp. We already had our own version of CCTV and surfing. So still to say that we can definitely empower through design, but our goal is to improve the quality of life. And to do that, we might have to change the equation that rather than giving Gandhian currency the value, we have to make Gandhian value itself the currency. Let's not adopt green because it pays back. Adopt green because it's the need and it's ethical to do so. And that's why I believe in India we have the kind of repository of knowledge which we can help. It can help us not to reinvent alphabet from A. We can pick up from Z and take it to alpha, sigma, whatever further. So inspired by yesterday and inspired for tomorrow is the kind of motto and the solution for our future cities. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.